Welcome back, friends. So next up we have Andrew Clark giving his presentation, Cataloging the Beatley Library Zine Collection, The Evolution.
So normally catalogers end their presentations with a picture of the cat. I'm just getting my presentation from him. Shaking it up.
Great.
Okay, so this is Cutter. And she's suggesting that you follow CritCat on Twitter. Also, CritLib, CritLib, for those of you who are unaware, they have monthly Twitter discussions on various topics that occur the librarianship, so it's a great thing to follow. So anyway, I'm Andrew Clark, Discovery and Metadata Librarian here at the Beatley Library, Students College. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for asking me to do this. Thank you to all the organizers, Don, Des, Tony, and Young, etc.
We love you!
Y'all rock! It's going to be awesome weekend. What I thought I'd do today is talk about and show you all the various iterations that our approach to cataloging zines has gone through. And share some of the decisions that we've made along the way over the past few years. I'm definitely saying we, because this really has been and continues to be a collaborative effort in the library, not only the building and maintenance of the collection, but actually the cataloging itself. Without awesome folks like Don and Des and others, the records for the zines would not be nearly as good as they are. So it's teams of people. As I've talked before about our cataloging practices to various folks, I've kind of noticed a theme starting to emerge a little bit. And I'm kind of thinking of it as like compromise versus isolation when talking about the collection. So on the one hand, with zines, we're working with material that may not be properly served by the systems we have in place. Cataloging rules, embark records, classification systems, things like that. So it can be a real temptation to either look for other systems that better serve the material or just completely invent your own system. But on the other hand, from the beginning of this collection in our discussions, we really wanted the zine collection or the zines to really be like any other resource in the library. Our hope is to not make it like an isolated collection all by itself. We wanted to integrate it with the other resources. We wanted to create the opportunity that someone looking for resources, whether they're looking for books or ebooks, they may come across a zine that serves their needs as well. So we wanted that to just be part of the regular collection. Because, as we all know, zines are just a valid resource as anything else. Right? So, to that end, we compromise. We use the systems. We jam the metadata into MARC records the best we can. We use the subject headings. Someone searching for a particular subject may find a zine that's relevant to them and to their needs. If that means using LCSH, that's a compromise that we have to make. And more about LCSH later. So, also compromising using the systems. That being said, it doesn't mean that we can't bend the rules that we're using. We can break the rules if we need to. Whatever works to serve both the material and the papers is the real goal there. So, before we talk more about breaking rules, stuff like that, I want to tell you about the humble beginnings of the Beatley Library. Look at that nice metadata, isn't that great? So back in the fall of 2014, Dawn wanted to use some zines for a session in a sociology class. And you had just recently started, or were fairly new to Beatley at that time.
Yeah.
So Dawn comes walking into my office. That was when I had an office, but that's it. So Don walks into my office with a stack of zines and says, "Hey, can you catalog these?" And I'm like, sure what are these? Because at that point, I kind of knew what zine meant, but I didn't really have any idea what they were, what the community was like, really didn't know much at all. It was a learning experience for me, but I gave it my best shot. And so this was for a class, so we had to come up with a solution pretty quickly. So this is the first iteration. It was a book cart on a circulation desk with zines on it. And I like how I put here that this is the publication information. I also did like minimal cataloging for each individual title, mostly just author title stuff, and the location of all this. We worked out. It worked out fine for what we needed it to be. It was successful in that iteration. It worked. After the class was over, Don was given the go-ahead to start a permanent collection. So we met, we talked about it, we strategized about how we're going to handle this, because there were really a lot of things to consider in building this collection, because as Rhonda touched on, it's kind of a unique thing. So there's a lot of like little details that you have to consider when you're adding this sort of unique sort of material to the collection. Just kind of a lesson that's been sort of reinforced going through all these processes for me is that it's really okay to go ahead and just try something. Hopefully you're given the freedom to do so. We didn't wait until we had perfect policies or procedures in place. We just kind of went for it and adapted as we went, made some mistakes, and it's still adapting and improving. So that was really reinforced for me. This is the next iteration, and I'm actually going live into the catalog. It's very exciting. This is kind of the next iteration of our cataloging records. We have title, we have some actual publication information. This is apparently still in my office somewhere. One thing, so in this description field, I thought this was a great idea, just to put this in the template, just sort of a placeholder for like the page numbers and the measurement and stuff like that. And now I'm looking back at these, and I'm like, why didn't I just count the pages? Because now I have to go back and actually grab the zine. I thought it was a good idea to speed things up. That was a misjudgment. And speaking of mistakes that were made, Don had found at the Anchor Archive in, where are they? Somewhere in Canada.
Yeah.
Halifax. Thank you. They have it's a big zine library. They have some great resources on the website, and they have these the three-letter category codes for these sort of broad categories. And we decided that that's how we're going to arrange the collection by these broad categories, right? What I tried to do is I tried to map these broad categories to Library of Congress classification numbers. That did not work. I tried, I tried really hard, but it just ended up not being feasible. Library of Congress classification numbers are very specific when we're dealing with very broad categories, so I was just trying to, going through the tables, trying to find something that fit, but eventually gave up on that, and we just used broad categories. What I was trying to do, like I was saying before, was to integrate the collection in with the rest of the materials. So if someone was browsing by call number, they'd come across books, ebooks, and zines as well. But it just didn't work. It was trying too hard to sort of jam that into the existing systems. So we decided just to stick with the three-letter codes. So it was a bit of a sacrifice there. After the call number failure, I had to actually figure out how to catalog. Went to the literature, tried to look for some stuff. There is a fair amount out there about zines in libraries, zine librarianship, that kind of thing. Not too much about cataloging. I did find a couple really helpful and valuable resources for me. Two book chapters, one by Jenna Friedman, called AACR2, Bendable But Not Flexible, Catalog Museums at Barnard College, from the book Radical Cataloging. That was huge. And then another chapter by Jenna and Byron. So thank you for that, for cutter and paste, a DIY guide for catalogers who don't know about zines, and zine librarians who don't know about cataloging. And that's from Agitation, Library and Information Skills, and Social Justice Movements and Beyond. So yeah, so those two were really helpful just to kind of give me an idea of how other catalogers were approaching these things. So yeah, just to go over, and like I said, we talked about this, we made decisions together, and some of those early decisions in how to deal with this collection were columners, like I said, we were just going to use the codes, the broad category codes. We wanted it to be definitely to be a circulating collection. We didn't want it to be archival, and this is separate from the student-produced scenes, which we do for the archives. But the main collection, we wanted it to be circulating. We collect mostly recent material, and we wanted them to be easily accessible for people, and we wanted them to be used. We wanted people to be able to check them out and take them home and actually use these things. In terms of physical processing, we decided that nothing would go on the zine itself. And that was just logistically sensible because a lot of them are really tiny. A lot of them, you know, don't have traditional covers, so there's information on the outside that you don't want to cover up. Things like that. So we had the solution of just the archival plastic bags with the backing, which seems to work just fine, and all the stamps and barcodes and stuff go on the outside of that. We worked out a temporary shelving situation with prints and files, and that's gone through quite a few iterations too. What are we on, our fourth shelving solution?
I guess it would be called a solution.
A shelving situation.
It's a situation, yes.
So those were kind of the processing decisions we made. As far as cataloging, we made a decision to catalog all of the zines as monographs, no matter what they were, not as serials. That was a pretty big decision, I think. Some other catalogers have approached them as like monographic series, or like on a case-by-case basis. Some are monographs, some are serials, that kind of thing. But one of the reasons for that decision was that since we were shelving them by these broad categories, different issues of a zine may fall under different categories, and so they would be in different places anyway. We figured it would be best served to just have one record for each one. And some other reasons too. A big one for me was that it just made things easier. I didn't have to think about it. I think another really important decision was to not do any authority control on author names. So normally my job as a cataloger would be to have a name on a resource, do some research, find out if that creator had used any alternate spellings, any alternate forms of the name, look into if they're using pseudonyms, things like that. And the reason for that is to bring all the works of one creator together, to co-locate those things so that if you're interested in a creator, you can find out everything that they produced. But with zines especially, privacy is really important. And there's a certain question of ethics of what you want to do with these creators' identities. Because people use pseudonyms for a reason. Someone may not want to be associated with something that they produced years ago. Any number of reasons why it's important to respect that privacy. So we decided for what we're going to put in the records, the source that we're going to use for the creator's name was just the zine itself. And that was it. Whatever appeared on the zine, that was going to be the creator's name. No further research or anything like that. So that's a compromise because there may be cases where there's a creator may make several zines. They may have variations in their name, and those just aren't necessarily going to be brought together. But I think. think that's a, you know, that's a compromise that I think is worth it in this case. So then another kind of important strategy that we developed was how the catalog procedure was going to work. So I didn't really have time to do deep subject analysis for all the zines. And I really didn't and still don't know the zines to our culture as well as Don, Dez, etc. So we worked out a system of pre-cataloging. So this is something that Don had done in the beginning and Dez has done. So they have a spreadsheet and they record the basic metadata on the spreadsheet. Author, title, just some basic stuff. But what's really important is that they add summaries, either write them themselves or take them from the zinester, from the author, and provide those summaries that I can put in the records. And that's really important because in our system, the summaries are keyword searchable, so that that adds to discovery. So if someone is searching by keyword, they might find something that's not represented necessarily by subject headings, things like that. And then another thing that got added in the spreadsheet are suggested subject keywords by the pre-catalogers. And that's hugely helpful for me because that gives me a starting point to look for subject headings. And like I said, it's basically having the subject analysis done for me, which saves me a lot of time, even though I do read a lot of this. I think that was really key for our process, was to have that sort of collaborative cataloging situation going on. And then later, the spreadsheet itself got more complex. They started adding page counts and measurements, and later, more physical details, that kind of thing. So it just increased in its complexity and really provided a lot of help for me. So, because of all these decisions and this new procedure we had in place, we were able to make records that were fuller than something like this. So this is the next iteration of our catalog records. My favorite title ever. So we have full title stamp responsibility, author publication information. We have some addition. This still is not good. But now we have some subject access. The call number situation has been figured out here. That's our three-letter code. We have a nice summary here. This one's supplied by the Zinester. We try to get that as much as possible just because it's better to have their own words describing the material. So that's kind of the next pretty full record situation that we had going on. Just a little bit more about Zinester privacy and respecting that, just in terms of the publication information. So location also may, that has some issues too. You don't necessarily want to do deep research and find out exactly where these people publish their work. So we decided that good sources or appropriate sources for finding that information were of course, the zine itself, if they explicitly stated where it was published or if they had contact information in the zine, those two things would work for location. The second acceptable source we decided on was if they had like a very obviously public-facing web presence, like an Etsy shop or a Facebook page talking about their zine, where basically it says, hey, I made this zine, this is where I'm from. So if it's obvious, then we can use that as well. Things like, old interviews or blog posts or something like that, then we don't really use that as a resource. We also don't try to guess from like the narrative of the zine. So if it's explicitly stated on a zine or a public facing webpage, that's fair game. For year of publication, that's where we do, the research and pretty much try to find that. As much as possible. That's an important piece of information, I think, especially when you're building a collection, just to get some historical perspective. And I think that's, it's less intrusive on the privacy of the zinester. So that's pretty much, that's, I look everywhere I can, just to get an idea of when that might be published. As an aside, so when I was in library school sitting in cataloging class, I never thought that I would be getting paid to look at so many Etsy shops and talk. Could be worse. All right. So this is, like I said, this is a pretty full record. I was pretty happy with that. I cataloged at this level for a while. But then eventually I wanted to do even more with these records. I wanted to have absolutely complete full mark records, all the fixed fields, all the technical mark stuff that's supposed to be in there. I wanted them to be compliant with RDA, which is the new cataloging rules, new-ish. And then I became really interested in the physical description aspect of these things. Coming at it almost like looking at artist books, things like that. Zines as objects themselves. So I wanted to, you know, put more description in the binding, talk about the illustrations, talk about the size, the format, things like that. Because there's such a wide variety and such an interesting, I think it's just such an interesting aspect of the material that I really wanted to put some of that in the record. So the next iteration. All right. So, yeah, nice title, nice long statement of responsibility there, a corporate author. Here's some info. Now, for this place, that's in brackets because that wasn't on the zine anywhere, but one of the authors was Support New York, so I went to the website. They actually are in New York, so I felt comfortable putting that there. And then finally, thanks to the pre-catalogers, yay, we have page counts and measurements. That's awesome. You know, some good, some decent subject access, summary again supplied by the authors, adding all the alternate authors, things like that. But in terms of physical description, what we started doing is adding two note fields. In the 500, which is a general note field, we put the size information and a little bit of description of the illustrations. And then in this note field, the 563, which is specifically for binding information. I think it's mostly used for like rare books and things like that, special collections, but I took it to describe the binding of the zine, how it was bound, and what the covers were like.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Right. I love it.
We don't really have like a standardized language for this.
There is one.
There is one.
Yes. I'll talk about it when I talk.
Yes.
It's from Queerzine Explosion, which Larry Bob Roberts put out in the 90s. And at the beginning of every issue of QZE, he had a whole set of codes that he used to describe standard zine sizes, both European and North American. And so that's what we use at QZE.
Oh my god.
I'm so excited.
Oh my god.
Sorry, I didn't mean to blow people's minds so early.
No, that's so awesome.
It's like 2 o'clock already.
I mean, we have a list of like 4 terms or something like that.
Holy smokes.
I'll show you.
Yeah. That's great. Yeah, so now we're going to have a standardized way of describing it. But also with, you know, talking about the illustrations and covers, we just have a sort of general patterns that we follow. But we'd like to standardize that a little bit more in the future. Let's see. Right, so we have those two note fields and the measurements. Okay, one last example. Hey, there's a familiar name.
Oh. What are these?
Yeah, awesome. They're all on reserve. Neat. All right. So this is kind of where we're at right now. This is the sort of the, not the final iteration, but this is our current iteration. Full mark records. I'm finally starting to remember to add the later terms to the creator names, so author there. And then we have good description, subject headings, summaries, etc. The last little tweak that we made for the physical description was to divide the size and illustration descriptions into two separate note fields, just making sure all the metadata is separated out, just in case we want to. Something with that later. now let's take a look at the subject headings for this scene. This is a genre form term, zines, and that actually does come from library numbers. This one does not, also a genre form term. So we have a list of local genre form terms that we use that are specific to zines, so per zine, split zine, mini zine, that kind of thing. And we like to add that descriptive element as much as possible. The subject heading Zine Fests is not from Library of Congress.
Okay.
Surprise, surprise. Right? Yeah, that would be just too awesome for them.
Right.
so yeah, that's a local subject heading that we use. LCSH. Let's talk about that for a second. So we like to co-locate resources by subject. Right? We like to bring together resources of the same subject, have subject access, etc. So LCSH is helpful in doing that. But of course, at its core, it's a white, cis, straight, male, supremacist system. And it's old. And it's slow. So we don't use it all the time. I do want to say, though, too, that there are some pretty awesome folks working on proposing new and changed subject headings to Library of Congress. One really cool approach, cataloginglab.org. Does anyone know that? Oh, that's Violet Fox. She launched it recently, like within the past few months. But it's sort of a there's forms where people can easily suggest new headings, and it's sort of like crowdsourcing. So a lot of different people can work on this process because proposing new subject headings is difficult, and you basically have to know, you know, how to create a full perfect subject authority record just in order to propose something. I don't know how to do that, so we use other things instead of that. But I did want to point that out, that people are trying to change the system. It's just slow to change, and we want to get the scenes out. When LCSH is inadequate or when it's offensive, we try to use alternative subject thesauri. The Anchor Archive, again, has a great list of subject headings they use for their zines. So we look at that every once in a while. Homosaurus is another good resource that we use time to time. And then we also have a pretty small but it's growing list of local subject headings that we use when we can't find them anywhere else, like white supremacists. And just to kind of go back to Dawn and Stacy, and talking about the pre-cataloging with keywords, which is super helpful. The student magazines, like I mentioned, the students themselves suggest keywords and subject headings, and that has really it reinvigorates the subject the subject headings and the subject access, I think. Taking the language from the creators, from the zines themselves, I think that's really that's a smart way to go in terms of subject access. We could talk about subject access for a long time, so I'm just going to leave it there for now. Just back to the records for a minute. This is where we are now. I'm happy with these records. I think they have a lot of good information in them. I think they're very discoverable in a lot of ways. What we'd like to do going forward, a couple things. We want to continue developing and using our list of local subject headings and local genre form terms. We want to standardize the physical description fields so they're consistent with one another and pull in terms from existing thesauri whenever possible. We do have to go back and recatalog all the zines that aren't up to this level someday.
So backlog.
I know. And we have to get through our 300 zine backlog.
Oh, yes. Yes.
So, yeah, no problem.
Maybe you should get me all the time.
I put that in the notes, Cookie.
Did you?
Do you guys have zine interns? Yeah, right there.
Beauty!
also I've been, I mean, my approach to cataloging zines is, it's really anti-catalog. I mean, it's not anti-catalog. It's not.
You're gonna get kicked out of catalogers.
I know. It's not something a cataloger would normally admit to, I guess. But I let anyone who wants to catalog zines just get in there, and you know, if you don't put a space before the colon, I'll fix it or whatever. Who cares? You know. So I'm recruiting people. Our staff is amazing, and like everybody wants to catalog zines. So it's fantastic. Like I said, it's a library wide effort pretty much all around. That's our records. One thing I want to end on, it's just something I've been thinking about, kind of putting this talk together, and it kind of goes back to this theme of compromise versus isolation. So I don't catalog these in OCLC, the big shared union catalog. I don't upload my records to OCLC. There's a number of reasons, mostly because, we have some idiosyncratic practices. I broke some cataloging rules here and there. And so say, someone had already cataloged a zine that I'm cataloging and it's up on OCLC, I don't want to put my record up there also, because you're only supposed to have one record, really. There's not another record, and I just put mine up there, then technically pretty much anyone could go in and fix it. And then the way our system works, that'll get updated in my local system, and it'll change. Those were the reasons, those were the sort of justifications I came up with for not putting these on OCLC. But I'm kind of asking myself now, does this isolate our collection from the rest of the zine libraries' collections? I don't know. Cataloging is all about sharing records, I think. I'm not questioning, but I'm just thinking about, is this a good approach that we're taking with not sharing these records? I'll share my records. Also thinking about, with this metadata, this rich metadata, will it crosswalk easily with something like ZineBoard? Is data going to be lost? Is it going to be hard to crosswalk? Is it going to fit into something like the Zine Union catalog? Just some things I've been thinking about. Any thoughts on that would be welcome. That's it. Thank you for listening. I'm just cataloging in our local system, Millennium.
What system do you have?
Millennium. Yeah. I just have the spreadsheet open, just copy paste the summary. And, yeah.
Okay. I've been doing kind of similar like bulk things like that with just like our serial monographs, and like putting things into a spreadsheet, and then converting those, each of those, into a park record. And we use Olive.
Oh, okay. I think our process is not big enough to make that worth it, I guess. Because usually it's, I'll catalog a zine during lunch, and that's, or two on Fridays, maybe. It's a smaller operation. Plus, I like to just go through the metadata, too, and just double-check stuff.
Oh, yeah.
I want to know if you could talk a little bit more about, because I know we've had conversations about like elaborating on the physical description of the zines, but I'm interested in hearing a little bit about how like your sort of art book background or like your sort of like previous iterations have like impacted like how you approach zines in general.
Yeah. I'm really interested in binding just in general. I also worked in rare books for a while, and their descriptions are just amazing. Talking about the half calf with the raised bands and the gilt, whatever. Obviously, a lot of zines are, it's stapled. So, But, you know, there's exceptions, and I like to point out those idiosyncratic, I can't say that. I like to point out the weird little approaches that people take. And just in terms of like visual art and being interested in artist books, you know, even the zines, you know, a lot of the zines that I've seen, a lot of the prozines, it's kind of a standard black and white collage, you know, the cutout text. But even the variety in that, I think, is interesting. I'm really interested in the creative process. I mean, I know really the content is the important part, but I like the sort of just the creative aspect behind that, and the way people's brains work when they're like, I want to say these things, but I want to present it this way.
You're capturing my creative magic.
Yeah.
Exactly, because I feel like the form is so much a part of the content with zines in ways that like other media aren't.
Right, definitely.
You rock.
I like your question about sharing and isolation in SDLC.
Yeah.
So I feel like if this is kind of like, I think of this as a rare book.
Yeah.
Then, I don't know. Well, yeah, but yours is a lot of reality. Yeah, no, it's a really good question. Do you guys ever like lend out your zines throughout a movie or anything?
I feel like we got a request and it was because it actually had an ISBN number on it.
Oh, right.
But it came from Microcosm, something like that.
Yeah, a couple from Microcosm, I'll copy it along those.
Yeah. I wouldn't be opposed to it, it's just that I haven't.
Yeah, how would they be finding
it? Yeah.
How would they find it?
Yeah.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
So is your collection circulating or is it reserved?
Circulating.
Okay.
Yeah.
There are several on reserve for those classes. So.
Right.
Sure.
Yeah.
But and if it's circulating collection, then theoretically doing it through ILL would be fairly simple. You just read it like anything else, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. In theory. I don't know why. Why don't we do that?
Why don't we ILL?
Yeah.
Nobody's asking for them.
Yeah. Nobody's asking.
I guess they can't find them.
Yeah. Findability. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. They'd have to actually go to New York.
But if I went to the Simmons catalog
and
said, hey, can I get this, you know, or talk to my librarian at UWM and said, can you help me get this from Simmons, then you could ILL it.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Would you be opposed to having the collection road? Like
have
sort
you
of like a traveling collection?
Not at all. I think that would be awesome. Dawn has taken some zines around the faculty members, is that right?
Stacey and I have on our roadshow.
Travel roadshow.
That's right, roadshow.
The anti-oppression roadshow.
Yeah.
And then, like, you know, working with the local libraries maybe to have a display or something like that.
You mean like kind of like lend out parts of the collection to other institutions? That's a cool idea.
Make a zine.
Yeah, that is cool.
And
then we
can make
zines.
That's
cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
you
cool.
You all can do is zine.
Yes.
Yes.
And demonstrate like desire for a zine library. Well, I mean, I'm subversive and like I'll just like
full stop. Stop.
One example. Like I'll grab. I have zines and I just slip them in while I'm cataloging. It's just like me and like my boss, like Dolly. Like, we're the ones cataloging. I'm like, I'll do this one. And then like. When we do have a zine collection, like we can pull out those because they have a form genre for zines.
Mm-hmm.
We can sort this out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot to point out that all of our zines, we have several ways to co-locate our collection, either the catalog, the non-form term, plus our alternate title. The BDLE zine collection is officially known as the To the Front zine collection. And Dawn, do you want to talk about the origin of that term?
Yeah, so it was a throwback to like the 90s, the Riot Girl, but my idea was that this was really a call for other marginalized groups to be to the front now, to have that chance. So that was our official, title.
Yeah.
Wasn't that also a book?
Yes, it is actually. Speaking to Milo with ILL, Andrew has spoke about this too, we don't circulate anything or purchase anything that would be, like, of course we would be very sad if something left and never came back. But there is nothing that we have, we're like, oh my god, this thing was made in 1990, and we're never, like, we're not in the business of, like, archiving it.
Right.
So if it disappears, I feel that maybe that person, like, needed that zine more, and, like, it needed to be on the show. But yeah, so I wouldn't have any issues at all about lending them out. And Des uses Airtable, right? Are we still using that?
No.
Okay, we're not using it anymore.
That's it. But there's, I think it's super cool too. So thinking about, like, the sort of union catalog and in progress, or like the idea of doing that with zines, I think one of the things that's really cool about running the show locally is that we are able to, like, have more descriptions and things that are tailored to, like, what our library community and campus community cares about. Like, even working with Paper Cut, like, we're not super standard. It's, like, totally volunteer run at this point. So there will be some standardization that will need to happen. But it's also cool to be able to make sure that, like, the descriptions reflect the sort of, like, community that we're serving in a way that you would maybe lose by having, like, submitting it to OCLC or whatever. But Jenna does she do OCLC records? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We have special collections on top of OCLC.
Are you going to talk about the catalog?
I can, a little bit, yeah.
Stay tuned, Nicole.
Because you're talking about, like, findability and, like, I mean,
I go back for shit, but...
I go to WorldCat, and it doesn't move from WorldCat, it doesn't make sense to me.
Right.
So, I think, like, eventually,
like, I'm curious, like, do folks have thoughts about what's getting them lost in that process? But, like, how many do you need to know?
Yeah, but, like, there's also things, like, if you use your catalog as the graphic that you're using, or the you're using mark, you using all those, like, cataloging things. So, like, you did it as an archival collection, like, you have different ways to use archives created, and different ways of finding those things, like, But choosing to go this route, I feel like it's so much more standardized. The archives, you have a lot more flexibility to do that, but then you can
But also at the same time, I feel like finding these aren't accessible, like inherently not accessible. So, like, one of the projects I've been working on with these folks is digitizing the collection of zines that have been made by students in classes on campus, and then putting that into the digital asset management system, what do we call this? I'm thinking about, like, there are, like, that in that case, it's not even, like, necessarily archival description or anything. It's just, like, these little forms, and, like, we had to talk about, like, what we wanted to include in that, because basically it's the same system. That's the other, like, technology sort of component of the cataloging thing, is, like, what are the limitations of the basic tech, and, like, do you have the opportunity to, like, talk with your tech folks to, like, is there wiggle room here, or are you just really, like, using the same shit that they're using for the thesis and dissertation, which is what we're using. So some of those limitations are already imposed, like, by what you're doing. Like, it's not like a mark field. It's also not really like a finding aid field, so it's really just like, here's basic information, and where do you put finding stuff? Like, there's no physical sort of thing. Yeah, so it's interesting.
The core is, like, also
exactly, yeah. So, and it's, like, mostly the open core, but it's also been interesting. So for the paper cut cataloging we've been doing, we basically made a Google Doc form that's more or less like Zine Core, basically, and after doing, like, a couple training sessions with volunteers, like, literally people just come on Sundays and, like, hang out and catalog zines.
Yeah,
and it's, like, very straightforward.
You're doing it almost like an inventory. Like,
that's what we're trying.
Yeah, like, I mean, inventory.
Exactly. And so then we're able to also sort of, like, reflect. And then we're also, as we're going through, we're also, like, identifying stuff with potential leading. And, like, we don't really have a collecting policy, but, like, we're thinking about, you know, do we need all these, like, Dubrow's theater mags, or are we focused on, like, building, like, this as an anarchist political collection, which is what the startup is. Down the road, we've got a catalog of 1,000 or so people right now.
said that when you were getting started and you were doing research, you hadn't been finding a whole lot about cataloging zines, mm-hmm. and that you found something that Jenna had written and mm-hmm. something that Rhonda had helped co-author. Mm-hmm. And I think it's time that you write the document.
Yes!
I wrote the document on collection policy. I helped her co-write the collection policy document, and I'm not even a real librarian.
So are.
I feel like you could totally zine library site info and you know, you could do that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. You got time.
Summertime. Summertime. I'm gonna be hounding you. I'm gonna be like, Andrew.
Yeah.
We need this.
Okay.
Zine librarian book. We need to make a book.
No, there is a book.
There isn't, but we've been talking about it.
Yes.
We've been talking. Stay tuned for further updates on that.
Librarian conference discussion.
Yes.
That would be so good.
I have to